Good morning, everyone. Thank you for showing up and making this such a wonderful event. My name is Bill Klein. I am a senior fellow at the Academy for Capitalism and Limited Government. Oh, I pointed to the sign, it's no longer there. Helping to co-host this wonderful event put on by YAF. And our next speaker, Bob Lawson, is actually a friend of mine and somebody that I look up to when I do my research. And so I'm very glad that he's been able to speak here today. And Bob Lawson is a clinical professor and holds the Jerome Fulwinder Centennial Chair in Economic Freedom. He's also director of the Bridgewell Institute for Economic Freedom at the Southern Methodist University, Cox School of Business. He earned his PhD and MS in Economics from Florida State University and his BX in Economics from the Honors Tutorial College at Ohio University. Dr. Lawson is a founding co-author of the Fraser Institute's Economic Freedom of the World Index annual report, which presents an economic freedom index for over 160 countries. Lawson has authored or co-authored over 100 journal articles and book reviews with Benjamin Powell. He's co-author of the Amazon bestseller, Socialism Sucks, Two Economists Drink Their Way Through the Free World, great book. His research has been cited over 10,000 times, according to Google Scholar. I have nothing more to add to his long list. I'd be here so long, so I'm just going to say it right now. Please let us welcome Bob Lawson and his talk.
Thanks, Bill, and thanks, YAF, Michael, everybody, for inviting me. It's really good to be here. It's really cool for me. I cut my teeth in the Reagan years myself. I was the College Republican president at Ohio University, go Bobcats, in 1986, in Reagan's second term. One of my lifetime greatest regrets, though, is I had not turned 18 before the 84 election, so I never actually got a chance to vote for Ronald Reagan myself. But it's certainly a pleasure to be even in the neighborhood, literally in the neighborhood, of one of my lifetime heroes. Time is short, so I'm going to get right into it. I'm going to talk about something called the Economic Freedom of the World Index that I've been working on all of my career since I was just about your age, actually. But before I do that, I want to talk about why I got involved as a young graduate student working on this Economic Freedom Index. There's a great debate that we've been having, and we are going to continue to have for probably ever, about how we should organize our society, and economically at least. How should we organize our economy? Should we organize our economy the way my hero, Adam Smith, suggested? I'm not wearing a tie today. If I was wearing a tie, it would almost certainly be an Adam Smith tie. I have, I think, 7 of them. That's one for every day of the week. My hero, Adam Smith, in the Wealth of Nations, published in 1776, as you know, he advocated something called a system of natural liberty. That's an old-fashioned term. I kind of like it. I'm an old-fashioned kind of guy. But what we would use today would be another term, probably capitalism, free enterprise, private enterprise sometimes, laissez-faire perhaps. There are a lot of terms we would use today to describe what Adam Smith called a system of natural liberty. But what it means in substance is a system based on private property, individuals owning the factories, the farms, the hotels, the restaurants, the bars, the schools, perhaps, and markets to organize these various people who own their property so they can buy and sell and exchange. Labor markets for workers, but product markets. And these markets would be free. And Adam Smith was an advocate for the free market, the freest of markets. And he was also an advocate for limited government. Wasn't an anarchist. I can be an anarchist after a couple drinks myself, but I'm pretty sober right now, I think. I'm not an anarchist at this hour of the morning, but ask me in about, after I go to the Cubs game this afternoon, I'll be an anarchist by about the fourth inning. And I hope they lose. I'm from Cincinnati, so. So that's my hero, Adam Smith, over there. And then along, a few years later, this guy Karl Marx came along, half a century later, and he said Smith and these economists were crazy people. These classical economists were wrong. These economists like Smith were wrong. In fact, capitalism, and you might know that capitalism was the term that Marx popularized. He didn't invent the term, but he really was the popularizer of the word capitalism. Marx thought capitalism would be a disastrous system. If you've studied Marx, which I really hope you haven't, but if you've studied Marx, actually no, I hope you have studied Marx, because you need to know who the enemy is. But if you've studied Marx, you will know that Marx has a long list of claims about how capitalism works, some of which are correct. He thought capitalism would be a pretty productive force, but he also thought it would be a very destructive force on some margins, like it would exploit the poor, we'd have something called alienation of labor, we would have business cycles, monopolies, and ultimately, according to Karl Marx, the system of capitalism would become so oppressive, for so many people, that the working class would violently overthrow their supposed capitalist overlords. So what we have here is the two of the greatest figures in the history of economics, Adam Smith and Karl Marx. One person, Adam Smith, saying, hey, free markets work pretty good. The wealth of the nation, good. We should do that. And then the other guy, Karl Marx, saying, no, capitalism's terrible. And somebody's got to be wrong here. Maybe they're both wrong, but these two people, one of them, they can't both be correct. They're saying really opposite things. And unfortunately, most of the debate that's gone on since Adam Smith and Karl Marx's day has been like these folks down here on the left. On the bottom there, is to, is not, is to. I remember my days as a college Republican. Most of my friends were communists, and I mean that literally. They would wear red armbands and march through campus with pictures of Mao on May Day. So they called each other comrade. It's crazy. So, but these are my drinking friends at Ohio University. Ohio University is very often in the top 10 in the party school list. So we would start drinking, and they would say, hey, you're a free market guy. You're like, yeah, what does that mean? It's like, well, we should have free trade. Like, that's crazy, it's gonna exploit the poor. And then have another couple drinks. Before long, they're calling me an evil, a dirty bastard capitalist pig, and I'm calling them a commie pinko or something. And after my years at Ohio University, not a single one of my communist friends was converted by my arguments with them. Maybe I'm just a bad arguer, and likewise, not a single one of them had any influence on me. Now, those are my fondest memories of college. My arguing with my friends, usually over beers, about these big ideas was my favorite time in college. I've forgotten everything I learned in classes. But at the end of the day, it really didn't get us anywhere. I'd like to contrast that with what happens in the natural sciences. Now, I'm a frustrated natural scientist. If I was 10 more IQ points smarter, just 10 more points, I'd be an astrophysicist today. But when you're not quite smart enough to become an astrophysicist, you become an economist. So here I am. But I still go to physics seminars at SMU, where I work. They're very kind enough to let me sit in the back, and I pretend to know what they're talking about. But I like physics. I still like physics. I like to pay attention to the trends and so forth. And I notice that in the natural sciences, like physics, they have disagreements too. They disagree about how things work. They'll be reading the same sort of data, and one group of scientists will say, well, I think this star is doing this, and the other people say, no, I think this star is doing that this is the process of that, and whatever. But at the end of the day, how in the natural sciences do they settle their debates? Do they argue each other? Do they get drunk and call each other commie pinkos at the end of the night? No. They gather more data. They conduct an experiment. They put a better telescope, like the James Webb telescope, which I'm very excited about. It's gonna be very cool. It's gonna be very, very cool. And at the end of the day, who can deny the progress that we, our society, has enjoyed because scientists, natural scientists, have been fighting with each other over the last couple centuries, and then going out and collecting better data, resolving those debates. So of course, most of the time when you resolve a debate, you only open up another one, but keep that process going. And we are now living in this marvelous technological age, in no small part because of the people like those ones in the white lab coats. I would like the natural sciences, like economics, to be more like the white lab coat guys and less like the screaming and yelling people, like the Facebook people, the Twitter people down here on the left, right? So with that in mind, let's talk about how I got involved in measuring economic freedom. My professor came into my office in graduate school in 1988. It was the second Bengals Super Bowl loss, not to be confused with the first one or the one I'm still too soon to talk about. And he says, we're gonna measure economic freedom. I'm his graduate student, so I'm like, yes, sir, how high, sir? Let's go collect some data. So we decided to try to put a number on how economically free, how close to Adam Smith a country is. Countries are gonna be our unit of analysis. So how Adam Smithy is the United States? How close to that system of natural liberty that Smith described in The Wealth Nation is the United States? And I'm going to try to put a number on it. We're going to use a 0 to 10 scale. 10 is going to be Adam Smith. 0 is going to be not Adam Smith. And that sounds crazy, like putting a number on freedom. Freedom's kind of a fuzzy concept. It's fair, it is. But we put numbers on things that are hard to measure all the time. All right, we put numbers on GDP. If you've taken an economics class, you had to listen to what GDP is. You know, your professor was up there, he's like, oh, it's the dollar value of all the new final, this is how economics professors usually talk, dollar value of all the new final goods and services produced in a country in a year. And then you fell asleep. But when I teach GDP, right after I teach my students the definition of GDP, I spend the rest of the class talking about all the problems with it, all the known accounting errors that GDP makes. What we're going to do, knowing that measuring things can still be valuable, even if we measure them imperfectly, like we do GDP, Jim and I set on this path to try to measure economic freedom. And I'm not going to get into the really fine details, but I want to try to describe the process that Jim and I go through every year. We do this, we've done this now every year for nearly 30 years, where we collect the data and create this economic freedom index. It's a data-driven index. All of the numbers that we use and generate come from other people's numbers. So let me tell you about the numbers that I use to create my numbers. Size of government. How big should the government be? Here I'm talking about tax and spend, like fiscal policy. How much money should they take from people? I'm a libertarian, so how much money should they steal from people and then spend it, all right? And Adam Smith has a chapter in The Wealth of Nations on the public finances. It's a very short chapter because Adam Smith was a very small government guy. In Adam Smith's Wealth of Nations, the role of government in a fiscal sense for tax and spend is to have a national defense to keep the French from invading. He was, you know, British, Scottish, but Scottish includes British, so British. And so national defense. You should have some cops, some police to, you know, to stop the bar fights at midnight. Also Scottish, that's a thing. And you should have judges to settle disputes, contract disputes, like if someone doesn't agree on who owns the cow. Rather than fight about it, they would just go to a judge, a respected person, and say, hey, I think that's my cow, and the other guy says, you know, I think it's my cow, and the judge would decide who owns the cow. So property rights disputes, those kinds of things, which happen in every society, we'd have courts for that. So we got national defense, cops, courts, and then he goes on, he talks about a little bit about what today we would call public goods in an economics class, or politicians might call infrastructure, but roads, bridges, maybe some ports, things like that, things that Adam Smith understood, just as modern economics textbooks understand, things that markets and private property owners might not do a very good job of providing, roads and bridges and things like that. And then there's a little bit about schools, although Adam Smith wasn't a big fan of public education, he did say that there was some role for the government to finance some of that, but he wasn't a big fan of it. His own experience in England at Oxford was pretty dreadful, which that was the government run, the big state university at that time. And he didn't really think that the state was doing a very good job of education, and I think many of us would agree with that statement today. But then the chapter's over. So we got what? We got national defense, courts, cops, judges, some roads and some bridges, maybe some schools, and that's it? Well, heck, the city of Dallas, where I live, owns a hotel. Adam Smith didn't think government should be running hotels. Daycare centers? Nope. Old age pensions? Nope. If you think about the size of government that you and I have here in the United States, suppose it's this big. Adam Smith's suggested size is this big. He was a very, very small government guy. So we collect data from places like the World Bank and IMF on how big the government is. It's really easy to do. Any of you could do it with your spreadsheets. And the governments that are big, like Sweden, get low scores. So big government means smaller scores. Kind of governments with smaller governments get better scores. Okay, second area, property rights, legal structure. This is the part of the index that measures how secure people are in their property. Most of these data come from surveys. The World Economic Forum, I know everyone's supposed to hate the World Economic Forum, but they do a nice survey and they ask people, business people in the countries all around the world, they ask them questions like, hey, how fair are the judges in your country? Like, how secure do you feel your property is? Things like this, very basic survey questions. And we get those questions. And the countries that where people report that the judges are fair, more impartial, where the property rights are more secure, those countries get better scores here. third area is sound money. This is something I didn't have to talk about much, but I'm afraid I'm going to have to be talking about more again here in the future. This is how secure you are basically in your savings account and your wallet, your money in your wallet. The first area is like how secure is your paycheck from government taking it from taxes? The second one is how secure is your property from maybe the government taking it for some purpose. The third one is about what a monetary economist call the inflation tax. I got an anecdote, this is a true story. When I turned 16, my dad pulled me aside and he says, son, you should get $100. Now notice my dad didn't actually give me $100. I didn't have that kind of dad. But I should get $100. Okay, thanks, Dad. I don't know where. Okay, but because I had just gotten my driver's license, and I drove a 1974 Volkswagen Beetle, and it was a piece of junk and broke down all the time. So the $100 would help get me towed home or help me pay a mechanic to help me fix it if I couldn't fix it myself. I should mention I still drive. I have a '60 Volkswagen Beetle. I have one even older now, but I know how to fix it now, and I'm rich. So I get this $100 bill, I put it in my wallet, and his idea was you fold it up as many times as you can, you hide it in a sort of recessed pocket of your wallet. A year goes by, I find that $100, and that's always fun when you find some money you'd squirreled away. But what's the problem? We all know what the problem is. If I take that $100 to the store a year later, if inflation's been 5%, that $100 is now only gonna be able to buy 95% as much stuff a year later as it would have bought the year I put it, when I put it in my wallet. It's almost like someone took $5 out of my wallet. Now they physically didn't, it's still literally the same $100 bill as I put into my wallet, but a 5% inflation rate acts like a 5% tax on that $100. In fact, it acts like a 5% inflation rate, which would sound kind of nice right now, wouldn't it? A 5% inflation rate taxes any dollar-denominated asset that you have. And let's think about what that's bonds, mortgages, insurance policies. Trillions upon trillions of dollars of pieces of paper floating around our economy are denominated in dollar terms. And every one of the value of all of those pieces of paper, the value of that mortgage contract, the value of that bond contract, the value of that $100 in your wallet or your savings account, the value of that is being taxed away by inflation. So the third area is we're measuring that, because governments are in control of monetary policy and therefore they're in control essentially of the inflation rate. And it's basically data on monetary stability and inflations. We also have a variable in there about can you own a foreign currency bank account. One of the nice things you can do to try to hedge and protect your savings account is have a dollar denominated account, but maybe you should also have a euro denominated account. Maybe if we have inflation, they won't. We tend to have inflation, they also tend to have it, but maybe you can hedge your bets a little bit by spreading your money around multiple currencies. So that's the third area. The fourth area is freedom to trade internationally, and this is the area that I think if you think about Adam Smith, the thing you should probably think first and foremost about Adam Smith is his advocacy for free trade. He was an early and unapologetic advocate for free trade. Now his time, he had this absolutely, I was gonna say a cuss word, but I'm gonna try to because there's a video guy back there. I've already said a couple, but I'm gonna try to limit it. He had this absolutely crazy idea that England should trade freely with the French. Now, France and England had been bitter enemies for hundreds of years. And this crazy Scotsman is saying that they should trade freely with the French. Like, this is an insane. Now, today, if I go out and poll 100 people here in Dixon, Illinois, and ask them, do you think we should trade freely with the Chinese or the Russians or the Brazilians or the Mexicans? I got a feeling that very, very few people are gonna give me Adam Smith's answer. So it was a crazy answer in Smith's day that we should trade freely even with our bitter enemies. And it's a crazy argument even today. And so Smith made that argument. So in this fourth area of our index, we just gather data from the World Trade Organization on tariff rates and quotas. We have measures of tariff barriers, quotas and things, capital controls. Countries that are more open to international trade, more open to capital inflows and outflows, those countries get better scores. Those are the more Adam Smithy countries. Now, I suppose we could debate the limits of that. All of these things have limits, but relative to all the countries in the world, Adam Smith was very much an advocate for free trade. And then the last area is regulation of credit, labor, and business. It's a hodgepodge of different regulatory things the governments do. We measure the minimum wage. And Adam Smith, there was no such thing as minimum wage in his day, but he had a lot to say about labor markets, and he was no fan of governments meddling in labor markets. He hated what we would call today unions, then it was guilds, things like that. He hated government rules and regulations related to labor markets. I know he would have hated the minimum wage. So countries that have high minimum wages get lower scores. You'd be surprised, there are a lot of countries that have zero minimum wages. other things in here, what's else in here? How many days does it take to start a business? One of my favorites, it's from the World Bank. How many days does it take to start a business? Now, it's a simple business. The World Bank estimates how long it takes to start a warehouse. Just a warehouse, you know, a building, trucks come up, drop stuff off, other trucks come, pick stuff up, a warehouse. Not a nuclear power plant, right? Just a warehouse. How many days do they say it takes to start a business? Well, in the United States, they say it takes 30 days, a month. This is not the business side of it, just the legal process, like going to the courthouse, filling out the, you know, what my name of my business is, getting a tax ID number, maybe, you know, whatever. The things that you need to do to start a warehouse. They say it would take about 30 days. I suspect in Dixon, Illinois, you could do it in a lot shorter than that, but probably in Dallas, Texas, or New York City, it's probably going to take, 30 days is probably a reasonable average. Not very long, but a little bit, a few weeks. I remember at one time, Egypt, it said 89 months. No, not months. It was, how long was it? I forget the number now. I got to go look it up. It was over a year, but not like 5 years, somewhere like that. And I do remember it was 42 procedures. They actually, so it's not just how long it'll take, but how many actual steps do you have to do? It was 42. So in Egypt, you had to go to 42 government offices. And it was going to take many, many, many months to start a simple business like a warehouse. Now, what happens in a place like Egypt when it takes 42 procedures and many months to start a business? No one starts a legal business. They either start the business illegally or they bribe their way. More often than not, they'll just bribe their way to shorten those many months and shorten those number of procedures down just simply by bribing. So what countries score well on our index? Those countries that keep their governments small fiscally. They tax and spend less. Those governments that have secure property rights, where the judges are trustworthy. Those countries that don't have inflation problems, those countries that are more open to free trade get better scores, and those countries that don't overly regulate labor markets and overly regulate businesses. So here's quiz time. I fear someone's gonna know. This is gonna be, I'd give this talk at normal colleges and everyone's there picking up extra credit and they don't care. But I got a feeling someone's gonna know the answer. What's the number one highest economically free place that we score in our index?
Norway,
no. Yes, sir. Switzerland's in the top five. Singapore's number two. Somalia, actually, it's a great question. As a libertarian, I'd love to answer that, but I don't have Somalia in my index. Yes.
Japan,
not bad. Singapore's the closest. How about Hong Kong? I know it's in a country. Okay, I said place intentionally. Hong Kong is number one, and for my purposes, Hong Kong is a country because they have their own money, the Hong Kong dollar, they have their own GDP. They basically, on economic affairs, still run themselves. We all know China is taking over, has taken over politically, and is now somewhat, unfortunately, exercising its political authority over Hong Kong. But when it comes to economic policy, tariff policy, monetary policy, tax policy, that's all still controlled by the Hong Kong government. And they're number one. They get about about a 9 out of 10. It's not perfect. There are some clear flaws to the Hong Kong economy, even from an Adam Smith perspective. But the top tax rate in Hong Kong is 20%. Billionaires in Hong Kong pay 20% and not a dollar more. In the top tax rate in the United States, in California, would approach 50%, 50%. Even in Texas, where I live, the federal rate, the top tax rate is what, 37% or something like that. Okay. Hong Kong has complete free trade, zero tariffs, 0.00 tariffs. They have no tariffs. They have no quotas. They have they have absolutely 100% Adam Smith free trade with no exceptions. How many days does the World Bank say it takes to start a business in Hong Kong? It says 30 in the United States. I forget how many months in Egypt. One day is what they say it takes to start that business in Hong Kong. Hong Kong is the freest economy that's ever existed on the planet Earth. And it's one of the reasons why I'm extremely sad to see what China is probably going to do there. But anyway, so far they're still number one. I'll talk about Hong Kong a little bit. Singapore, number two, almost all the same characteristics of Hong Kong they have in Singapore. But then after that, you get into more or less what you would think of as being the sort of Western industrial market or vaguely market oriented country. Switzerland, New Zealand scores well, the United States scores sixth, Ireland, Australia, Denmark. There are two former Soviet republics on there, which is pretty cool, the country of Georgia and Lithuania. I think Latvia is like, or Estonia is like 12th. So there's three, all the Baltics are pretty high, and then Georgia. And so that's pretty cool. I'll talk about that perhaps in just a second. So those are the top 10. The bottom 10 are countries you would probably guess as well, but North Korea, Cuba are not in my index. And you know, you might have figured that out. Listen to the data sources that I used earlier: World Economic Forum, World Trade Organization, IMF, World Bank. We don't get data for North Korea when you open up the World Bank tables or the IMF tables. They're not in these organizations, so we get no data. I know what they are. They're last. North Korea's last. If you haven't had a chance to read Yen Mi Park's book, read it. It's fantastic. I just had a chance to meet her this week. It's amazing. Cuba's probably second dead last, although we could argue that. Venezuela right now, though, is the lowest country we score, 165 out of 165. And this is somewhat tragic because they once were a fairly highly rated country and they've been sliding down under the Bolivarian revolution that's gone on in Venezuela. Other countries there, you'll see mostly African, Iran, Asian, Syria, so pretty bad. Now, there's way too many countries to show you them all, but here are some of the larger ones. The colors are indicating quartiles. So blue means you're in the top 25%. Green is the second 25%. Yellow is the third, and red is the last. And so when you see the blue countries, I'll show you a map in a second with the same color coding, but blue countries are basically the market economies in various degrees. The United States, we're a market economy. We have private property. Our judges are more or less safe. Our taxes are high, but they're not insanely high yet. And our inflation is low and so far and so far. So we're six. In Germany, Chile is the highest rated Latin American country, for those of you who are interested. And then in the greens, you get sort of they're market economies, but they're usually it means their taxes are higher or they're regulating more. So countries like the social welfare democracies, so-called Italy, France, Mexico, they're going to be the greens. And then the yellows are the ones that are sort of, they're nominally market economies, like on paper, but really you've gotten to the point now where the government's infusing itself in pretty much every aspect of business. And this is where you get Russia, India, Brazil, so-called BRICS. And then the red ones are the ones where governments are basically dominating the economy. And you'll note we still put China in that red category. They're right on the border between green, or between red and yellow, but Chinese economy has radically transformed itself towards markets, particularly in certain districts, as you know, like Shanghai and Guangdong province, Beijing, there's some other places, Guangdong. But generally speaking, if you average across the entire economy of China, it's still a totally government-dominated economy, particularly in capital and banking and finance. To this day, the banking and finance system domestically in China is entirely government-controlled, and that's not a small deviation from Adam Smith's sort of viewpoint. So here's the map. Again, blues, top 25%, the sort of greens, the greens and the yellows are kind of close here. But the greens are places like Mongolia, you'll see. In southern Africa, Botswana and Zambia are green. And then you get the yellows, Russia, Brazil, South Africa, so forth. And then the reds. My favorite thing to look at, you know, I grew up in the 80s, the Cold War, and the Soviet Union was still, I mean, it was the dominant concern of my upbringing. And it's been fun for me, as someone who grew up and sort of formed his worldview in Soviet times, to watch the breakup of the Soviet Union and watch the various constituent parts of the Soviet Union go their different ways when it comes to economics. Some of them, like the Baltics, Latvia, Lithuania, and Estonia, and also in the South Caucasus, Georgia, and also to a lesser extent, Armenia, they've all moved fairly quickly towards the West, towards market-oriented economic systems, and to the point where Georgia is like, what, sixth or something on that index, right? Fifth or sixth, it's amazing. I've gone to Georgia 17 times, so I'm a big Georgia fan. In fact, I get to eat Georgian food tonight in Chicago, can't wait. But you also see parts of the old Soviet Union like Estonia, which is still red. And so I have a lot of sympathy for the Estonians, but when it came to economics, they really have not transformed their economy that much from the Soviet times. They've privatized a little bit, but basically it's privatizing it from the state to some close friend of the state, like the you know, the president's brother-in-law or something. And so it's still a very, very government-controlled economy, as is Russia. One of the theses that I like to play around with in my head is how capitalism, how freer markets can make countries more peaceful. I look at what I see in the Ukraine-Russia thing right now, if I may editorialize, is not an evil, like, well, there is an evil country, and that's Russia, but what I see here is two very low economically free countries fighting a war, which is not particularly unusual, I'm afraid. What is unusual is seeing two high economically free countries fight a war. That doesn't happen. But seeing two low economic freedom countries like Estonia, or excuse me, like Ukraine and Russia fight a war is not terribly unusual. The other thing that I like to look at is Africa. This pandemic has thrown a wrench in this, but I think Africa is really doing a lot better than it used to. Now, it looks terrible there, doesn't it? But remember, I constructed this map by 1/4 of the countries are always going to be red. What this map kind of hides is the fact that in 1970, I have data back to the 70s. In 1975, red meant you got a score of 3 out of 10. Today, a red is a 5 out of 10, right? So all we've lived, not so much you, well actually yes you too, since you were born, we have lived through an amazing few years of liberalization, the last 20, 30 years. And that's hit Africa too. Now they're still kind of at the bottom, but the bottom's kind of come up and it's more compressed now. And that's, I'm actually bullish that some of these African countries, particularly the ones that are green or maybe even yellow, are maybe going to do very well. Unfortunately, COVID's really, really messed up everything on that front. But let me get to some punchlines. And I've got a few, just a couple slides at the end about Hong Kong, the United States, and one on I think, on COVID. Adam Smith was right, folks. I'd probably not a hard sell in this room, but Adam Smith was right. The wealth of the nation is higher in those places that are closer to his system of natural liberty. If you look, this is very simple. This is not high econometrics, but this is very simple. So the countries that are blue have average per capita GDP, the best measure we have of standard of living, of 50-some thousand dollars per person in the blue countries. And then as you go to green, it's 25. Half of that is the third, and almost half, half, and then half again. So it's 50, 25, 13, 6. So countries that are red on that map have average per person incomes of $6,000. Countries that are blue have incomes that are 8-9 times larger, $50,000. Adam Smith was right. The productivity, our prosperity hinges on getting something closer to a system of natural liberty. What's your friends back at your campuses big yeah but? And frankly, my friends back at Ohio University, they're big yeah but. Oh yeah, yeah, capitalism produces a lot of wealth, but it all goes to the rich, right? It all goes to the top 1% or the top whatever. Well, there are a lot of ways to slice the data. This is from the World Bank data. This is the share of income earned by the poorest 1/10 of the population. So you take the whole population, ignore the top 90%, just look at the bottom 10%, and then ask the question, what share of all of the income goes to the bottom 10%? Well, guess what? It isn't a lot, because that's what it means to be poor, but it's about 2.5% everywhere. You're in a red country, you're gonna get about 2.57. Okay, about 2.5% of income goes to the bottom 10th in a red country. What is it in the yellow countries? 2.1, green, 2.35. Blue, 2 point. What do I see there is a horizontal line, pretty much. If you do a scattergram, like a XY plot, it just looks like a shotgun blast. It's just a bunch of number dots. There is absolutely no relationship between income inequality and the kind of economic system you have. We have a lot of income inequality in the world within countries. Many people care about that income inequality. I care about it a little bit. I probably don't care about it as much as some of my left-wing friends, but I care about it. All right. But I have bad news for them and for the world. You're not gonna fix it by taking a blue country and making it red. Now you'll make the country poorer, but you're not gonna make it more equal. The data do not back up the common view that capitalism causes inequality. It simply does not. Now, if you want to get more complicated, I can send you journal articles later with lots of regression tables, and no one wants to, okay, no one's going to send me that email. All right. I wouldn't ask for that email if I didn't have to. Now, the next one is the share of income. The last one was share of income. The next one is the dollar amount of income. How much money does the bottom? So again, all the population, just look at the bottom 10% and then say, how much money does the bottom 10% get per person? Well, it's about $14,000 in a blue country. The bottom 10%, the average person in the bottom 10% of the population in a blue country has $14,000. That's not a lot of money. I wouldn't want to live on it. That's poor, right? But that's a heck of a lot better than $1,500. This is what the bottom person gets in a red country. And by the way, it's much worse in some individual countries than that. That's the average. The next one's poverty rates. You want those numbers to go down. It's a little blurry, but that's fine. My favorite one is life expectancy. I'll try to do this without tearing up. My favorite chart, so if you live in a blue country, your life expectancy from birth is over 80 years old. The U.S. is actually bringing that average down a little bit, thanks to our murder rate, really, and also our really, really dangerous highways, relative to a large part of the world. But whatever. So we're bringing that down a little bit. But you know, 81 years on average for blue countries. 65 years in a red country. Now that gap has closed a little bit since I've been doing this graph. But that's a lot. That's 15, 16 years. If you live to be 80 years old, you will live to see your grandchildren be born. Your grandchildren grow up, and probably will live to see your great-grandchildren, and maybe even see them grow up. The reason I almost teared up is my grandparents just died this year, and that damned COVID thing made it so that I couldn't go see them as they died, but I'm still angry about that. But if you're in a red country and you're dying at 65 on average, you'll see your grandkids be born, but you're probably not gonna see them grow up very much, maybe a little bit. And you're certainly not going to see your great-grandkids. And that's a sad thing, people. Ask your grandparents if they're alive. Bless you if they are. Ask your grandparents. It's the greatest thing that every grandparent says to say, this is the greatest thing to ever happen to me. They don't say that about their kids, by the way, but they say that about their grandkids. There's no way to become a grandparent without becoming a parent first. I've checked. But that's sad. Millions and millions and billions of people that live in these red countries, they are not going to get to enjoy one of life's greatest pleasures, which is growing up and seeing a grandchild grow up and prosper. Mortality goes down, blah, blah, blah. I got a lot of these graphs. I got a whole bunch of these graphs. They all look the same. Economic freedom is good, people. It's really good, empirically good. When your leftist friends say capitalism causes this terrible thing, they are wrong. I don't mean wrong like in a moral sense, so they're wrong. They are wrong as a matter of fact. And we have the numbers, all right? Okay, last graph is the happiness index. I think happiness index are junk science. Because they ask people like, how happy are you? And like, Jacob, how happy are you right now? Put a number on it. Seven, okay. I'm a 75.6 right now. But after a beer at Wrigley, I'm going to be an 89. And if the Cubs lose, I'm going to go down to like a zero. If the Cubs win, who do I want? I want the Cubs to lose, yes. All right. Right. So my point is, what do these numbers mean? What does it mean to say how happy you are? Like, I'm really unhappy before lunch, but I'm really happy after lunch, right? I mean, these numbers are really kind of squirrely, but they have these happiness indexes, and I'm happy, pun intended, to report that economically free countries, people in more economically free countries do self-report themselves to be happier, for what that's worth. But the reason that's in there is because somebody's always asking now, hey, I saw my professor use his happiness index. And guess what? Capitalism makes you happier. It makes you richer, but apparently it also makes you happier. As I mentioned, we are living through the greatest, well, we've lived through, maybe I should say more in the past tense, we have lived through the greatest economic liberalization in the history of humankind. The breakup of the Soviet Union in 91 alone was this. This is data just from 2000. I could do this further back. But just from 2000 to the present, the last 20 or so years, the index that we have on that 0 to 10 scale has gone up 0.4 points from 6.6 to over 7. If you go back, it's like I think it was like a 5.9 or something in 1990. So we've gone up by, you know, a full point. For you stat heads, that's about a standard deviation. And this has been pretty cool to watch as a professor, as a student of economic liberalization, as a student of economic freedom, to see more countries moving towards economic freedom, and only really a few like Venezuela going the other way. That's been a good thing. Been really fun to watch. However, Hong Kong, my favorite country, which I don't think I can go to anymore for political reasons, is going the wrong way. They were 9.10. As I mentioned, they're down a couple tenths of a point to about 8.9. You can see that it's kind of a squirrely thing, but it's more or less a downward trend. And all indications are that the Chinese meddling politically in Hong Kong is not going to stop at politics. In fact, the most recent rounds of crackdowns by Beijing inside of Hong Kong are economic measures attacking people's bank accounts and people's ability to do business in Hong Kong if they are critics of the government in Beijing. I'm projecting that number to go down. I'm gonna wait and see, I'll type the numbers. I'm just the monkey that types the numbers in the computer, but I'm 100% sure that number is not gonna go back up. Hong Kong, we've been writing about this in our report every year now for several years, warning and sort of sounding the alarm, and the Hong Kong government's not. I get an email from them every year. Oh no, we're fine. I'm like, no, you're not fine. Look at these numbers and read a newspaper, but they're not allowed to of course say they're not fine either. So it's a very serious problem. I project that they'll probably lose their number one spot inside of 5 years, the way things are going. We'll see. We'll type the numbers in. We'll see what happens. The United States has also kind of struggled. In the 70s and 80s, and Reagan, Thatcher, that whole wave, we began liberalizing. Even under Carter, we began to liberalize with deregulation. So the 70s, late 70s, the 80s, the 90s was the period of liberalization in the United States, privatization, not nationalization, decontrolling markets, deregulating, not regulating, price stability. Federal Reserve figured out how to do monetary policy and then they forgot again, apparently. But around 2000, we started to see the level off. And I work at Southern Methodist University, the President George W. Bush's library is on campus. I overlooked his library from my office. And I blame W a little bit because the reaction in the United States, the policy reaction in the United States to the war on terrorism, and then the financial crisis that came a few years after that, both were more government, more regulations. And our numbers, you can see a little bit initially, then came down. A little bit better under Obama, I hate to say that, but a little bit better under Obama. But that was mostly fiscal policy getting back under control, taxes and spending, more towards a balanced budget, things like that. And we're gonna see that number continue to fall. I'm 100% sure that next year's number is gonna be lower than this year's number because we're always 2 years behind. So I'm just getting into doing the 2020 numbers. And there was this little thing that happened in 2020, you might remember. And the US numbers, I know they're gonna plummet. We're gonna get crushed. I think all the countries in the world are gonna get crushed though. So I'm not sure if our ranking is gonna change much, but that number is gonna change from its current 7.7 or whatever it is. I'm gonna guess about 7.5, 7.4. It's gonna go down by 2 or 3 tenths of a point, which is a big change in our index. But of course, if every other country goes down 2 tenths or 3 tenths, we may not lose much ranking. Let me talk about COVID just a second. We're not done. My colleague and I at SMU are literally putting the numbers in for 2020 right now. So I don't really look too much at the final numbers until I've got them all in, but you know, I peek. And just in area one, the fiscal area, we're showing a full 1 point decline there. So that's gonna, if 1/5 of the index, that's 0.2, it's 0.2 on the overall index right there. So the US number is gonna be going down pretty dramatically just on the basis of area one. And we really haven't even started the other areas yet. So COVID, the policy response to COVID was absolutely speaking a diminishment in our economic freedom. Of course, literally closing businesses down by edict, banning people from evicting, basically eliminating lease, government meddling in lease contracts, which is what happened with the eviction moratorium. Government spending, dropping money out of helicopters, and then printing money to pay for it. It was just causing inflation. And we're not gonna see the inflation in 2020, but next year we'll start seeing that. So next year when I'm doing this talk, if they invite me back, I can report on how bad 2020 was and how bad I think 2021's numbers are gonna be, because they're gonna be bad too, because we're gonna start seeing that leading edge of the inflation. So it's bad. Now what if you were a, this is the last point. What if you thought we needed to do something about COVID? And opinions, reasonable people disagree on how much or what the government should do to deal with the pandemic. My answer is I don't care. Even if it's a good idea to shut businesses down, to drop money out of helicopters and do all the other things the governments did in the last 2 years, 2.5 years, even if all that's the greatest idea from a public health point of view, which is debatable, but even if it is the best idea, it is still a diminishment in our economic freedom, right? And my job isn't to measure those trade-offs. My measure is just to measure economic freedom. We lost economic freedom in 2020 and 2021, and we're losing it still in 2022 because of the COVID pandemic. It may have been worth it in the sense that it saved lives. It may not be worth it in case it didn't work. I don't know. Not my area of expertise. My area of expertise is government policy related to economic freedom, and that is definitely worse in 2020 and 21 and 22 than it was, say, in 19 and 18 and 17. So there you go. If you're interested, this is not really the website, but we have a short URL. It's freetoworld.com. The Fraser Institute in Canada is our publisher. You may have heard of the Heritage Index. Don't use Heritage. I'm sorry. I don't care. I get no money from Fraser. I get no money from Heritage. I don't really care. But I work on the Fraser Institute's version of the Economic Freedom Index. If you go to our website, it takes you to the Fraser Institute. There's the map that I just showed you. If you are in a class where the professor says, hey, run over, if you're not, God forbid, if you're in an econometrics class, God forbid, then and you don't know what to do, go grab our data and run some regressions with our data. There's also a state project I want to mention just briefly before I close. We have the Economic Freedom of North America, also published by Fraser, and it rates the 50 United States, I think 12 or 13 Canadian provinces, and I think 24 Mexican states altogether. So we've got a North American Freedom Index as well. It's based as much as they can do it on the same methodology as ours, but obviously there's going to be some differences when you're rating states than when you rate nations. That's it. How'd I do? All right.
Okay, students, we have time for one question.
I'm so sorry, I talk too much.
So whoever can get to the mic first, you're up.
Hi, my name is Steven. I'm from University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. So today you talked about during the late 2000s with the financial crisis and the housing bubbles in 2008 causing some severe troubles in our economy. So I wonder how do you think the free enterprise has anything to do with it, and how did this crisis happen?
Thank you. It's an excellent question. So the man on the street, unfortunately, the meme. Is that the word? Is that the right word? The meme that went around in 2008 was that capitalism failed us. Capitalism caused the financial crisis. The more broad claim is frequently from guys like Joseph Stiglitz, Nobel Prize winning economist. The claim is that capitalism, unregulated markets, gave us this incredibly bad economic Great Recession. I think most of that's nonsense, frankly, just straight up. But a very good economist friend of mine, John Dawson at Appalachian State University, he's actually collected data on business cycles and recessions. And what he finds is, guess what? Blue countries have fewer business cycles, fewer incidences of recession, fewer business crises than the red countries, the green, yellow, and reds. That's not to say you don't have them in economically free countries. And we could debate what we could have done to not have that financial crisis. I mean, I would blame a lot of government policies. I would blame the Community Reinvestment Act. I would blame, I'm a big fan of Scott Sumner, macroeconomist Scott Sumner, and his view that the Fed was actually overly tight in 2006, 7, and 8, and that caused the Great Recession. Right now, he thinks they're overly loose, which we're seeing in the evidence of inflation. But so we could debate the causes, but the grand claim that people are wanting to make now, the grand claim is that free market capitalism causes business cycles and recessions. That's wrong. It's empirically not true. In fact, we see fewer incidences of those in the more open, more free market economies.
Okay, thank you.
Excellent question. Thanks. And yeah. I talked too long, I apologize, but you all know how to Google. So if there's a question, if something that stimulated you, it's Google rlawson@smu.edu. Just Google me and send me an email. I'll be happy to answer any questions that I didn't get a chance to answer here. Thanks.